The prehistory of our practical physics. If in some cataclysm, all of scientific knowledge were to be destroyed and only one sentence passed on to the next generation of the creatures, what statement would contain the most information in the fewest words? I believe it is an atomic hypothesis, or the atomic fact, or whatever you wish to call it, that all things are made of atoms, little particles that move around in perpetual motion, attracting each other when they are little distance apart, but repelling upon being squeezed into the one another. In that one sentence, you'll see there is an enormous amount of information about the world if just a little imagination and thinking are applied. Richard Feynman, The Feynman Lectures in Physics, Chapter 1, Volume 1. Wow. So, naturalists observe a flier has a smaller flares that on him prey, and these have smaller still to bite in, and so proceed ad infinitum. Jonathan Swift, Poetry, A Rhapsody. So poetic, I don't get it. The particle physicists in the 20th century science. Particle physics is 20th century science, but in order to understand it, it's useful to go back in time a little bit and ask about the prehistory, the development of ideas that led up to our understanding of what the world is made of. So, I want to talk today about atoms and the idea of atoms. It's going to be useful to ask, what do we know? What do we believe today? And why? Why do we believe these things? I'd like to begin with a quote from a very famous physicist named Richard Feynman. Yes, Caltech, California Technical University. Caltech. No, the Technical Institute of California, whatever it is called. Feynman was a physicist at Caltech, yes, and he was a very influential player in the development of many of the ideas of the modern physics. He was, in a certain sense, responsible for the ideas that we have today of light, matter, and their interactions. Wow! Richard Feynman was also famous for his involvement in the investigation of the space shuttle explosion. He was one who discovered that it was an O-ring that was forgery in the Challenger explosion. Yes. Here is a quote from Mr. Feynman. If in some cataclysm, all of scientific knowledge were to be destroyed and only one sentence passed on to the next generation of the creatures, what statement would contain the most information in the fewest words? This is a typical Feynman, yes. It's a very creative idea. What one sentence can you come up with that carries the most useful information for someone that's trying to redevelop ideas of science? Here is his answer. I believe it is an atomic hypothesis, or the atomic fact, or whatever you want to call it. But all things are made of atoms, little particles that move around in the peripheral motion, attracting each other when they are far apart, repelling if you squeeze them too close together. That's it. In fact, in that one sentence, you will see that there is an enormous amount of information about the world, if just a little imagination and thinking are applied. That's Mr. Feynman's idea of single most useful sentence about modern science. The world is made of atoms. Wow. Once you appreciate this idea, you begin to understand the wealth of data, of ideas, of concepts, and how the world works. You begin to understand why gases behave the way they do, and liquids and solids, vapors. Just about anything that you can think of that describes the how the world works boils down to this idea that the world is matter, is world is made of atoms. This idea begins already 2500 years ago. There were Greek philosophers who were debating about how was the world constructed. Can you divide the world up into the infinite number of the little pieces? Or do you get to the bottom solid object, the atom? It was Democritus who had that idea at first, and at that time it wasn't really science, it was a philosophy. People were just debating and thinking about how they behaved, how they believed the world should be. It really wasn't until the 1700s and the 1800s that science began to develop an approach where you could ask the question of the world rather than asking the question of your ideas about the world. So this is a scientific method, right? You have a hypothesis. I propose that the world is made of atoms. Let us try to figure out what are the consequences of this idea. Let's think about the quantitative consequences and test them. Go into the laboratory. That testing begins in the 1800s with chemistry. Chemists are tinkering with combining materials and looking to see what happens. I remember when I was a little kid, I was given a chemistry set. You know, I was interested in the science and my parents must have thought that this would be the useful things for me. I didn't really like it so much because I didn't know what was going on. That's right. I had these chemicals, little vials, and they had instructions. They would say to mix two parts of this one with one part of that one, and hey, look, the color changes. It was kind of fun, but I didn't get it. Yes, the same for me. Yeah, there is no satisfaction at all because someone manipulating your idea. You know, someone is controlling you to have fun. I didn't have any idea of what was going on. Of the chemists of the early 1800s, John Dalton was perhaps the name most famous as a father of chemistry. He was doing the same kind of things as I was, but I guess he was a little smarter than I was when I was a kid. He began to realize that there is a great deal of order and regularity in what happens when you start playing with chemicals. Wow. One of the things that he investigated in particular was making careful measurements of weights. Yes. So, for instance, suppose you start with a BR of gas, which is identified to chemists in the early 1800s. Nowadays, we might call it as a flask of carbon monoxide. If you heat it up, maybe on some electricity, that gas will separate and out of it will come a little dust, some carbon dust, and another gas with different chemical properties, oxygen. Yes. You can weigh the oxygen that comes out and weigh the carbon dust that falls down, and what you'll discover is that the amount of carbon to amount of the oxygen always comes out in the same ratio. Wow. Again, you can weigh the oxygen that comes out and weigh the carbon dust that falls down, and what you discover is that the amount of carbon to the amount of oxygen always comes out in the same ratio, 12 parts carbon to 16 parts carbon. So he started doing this with a whole array of materials. Of course, they didn't call it carbon monoxide back then. That's the modern terminology, which reflects our understanding that carbon monoxide is a gas containing a carbon atom and oxygen atom. What Dalton's brilliance in the story really boils down to is he realized that you could explain it always comes out to 12 parts carbon to 16 parts oxygen.
Yes.
You could understand that if you have the idea in your head that carbon is a little physical entity that weighs 12 somethings, and oxygen is a little physical entity that weighs 16 somethings. Dalton didn't know what the unit was, that quantity, the mass of the individual atom, but he knew the relative masses.
Wow.
He knew the relative masses.
Wow.
So cool, so good.
Wow.
So as you go through all the different materials that were known, you begin to isolate various elements. Hydrogen is the lightest. Hydrogen on the scale would have mass 1, and then you have other elements, lithium, carbon, oxygen, and nitrogen. All of the fundamental elements are synthesized, isolated, and all of the processes that you can then do with these elements, like mixing them together and making the color change. Now, makes sense to anybody who's thinking about it, who talks with Dalton, reads his works, because now you understand that the world is made of atoms.
Wow.
Chemical reactions are nothing more than this. Take an atom from here and atom from there and combine them. The result will have a certain well-defined mass because the constituents did. Once you understand this idea, chemistry begins to fall into place. Instead of being mystical and a little bit magical, mixing beakers together, it just makes sense. Once chemistry begins to make sense, so does biology and geology, and pretty much any process where you are dealing with the physical materials and the amounts and the volumes, anything that you can measure about them.
Haha.
This idea was originated by chemists, but it was developed further by physicists. The physicists were more interested not in what happens when you mix stuff together, but for instance, you take a chunk of the materials and heat it up. If you add certain amount of energy, if you do a certain amount of work, how much does the temperature go up? It's a perfectly well-defined physical equation, and people went into the laboratory, so there was some data on this. The data, it turned out, fitted beautifully with the idea that the material was made up of the little atoms, little individual atoms.
Wow.
People began to understand, for example, the ideal gas loads. That's a phrase that refers to the fact that if you take a beaker or barrel of the gas with a piston and you compress it, the temperature might go up as the volume goes down, or the pressure might go up at first. That seems mysterious and a little bit magical. Then you say to yourself, look, let's imagine a balloon filled with a gas. Why is there a pressure? Why do I have to squeeze to make that balloon compress? You could just say that's a property of the balloons, but you could also say it's because there is a gas in there made of little, teeny atoms, little balls flying around like crazy, and they're whacking into the wall of the balloon. There are lots of them, right? They are tiny. So what you feel when you are pressing on the balloon, you are feeling whole bunch of little bumps, which average out to nice, smooth pressure, and if you squeeze it, then these little atoms have less room to jiggle around in. They are going to hit the wall more frequently and you are going to feel more pressure. You can even get a quantitative about this and put in some numbers. It all works. It makes sense. So the idea of atoms is developing. The primary philosophy here is we have this hypothesis. We try to make quantitative predictions and then we verify them in the laboratory. The picture is really quite simple underneath. It's explaining now, pressure of the gases, and as the time went by, people argued, ah, look, it explains temperature behavior. As you heat something up, it expands, stresses and strains crystal properties. It is a long list, and it continues to develop even today. The evidence for atoms is indirect. We are not actually seeing these little things. We are seeing the consequences, the scientific consequences of these things. Uh-huh. This was a physicist and an Austrian physicist. There was a physicist, an Austrian physicist in the late 1800s, Ludwig Boltzmann. He was a very interesting character. He developed the mathematics of the what's called thermodynamics. And statistical physics. Yes, statistical physics. Ludwig Boltzmann said, look, if you have, for example, a gas, it consists of a whole bunch of little atoms in there. This is a mental model that we have. We should be able to make the quantitative predictions based just on the probability and statistics. Wow! You've got a whole bunch of particles, for example, it's going to be just likely that they are working on the right hand side, as that they are going to be working on the left hand side, so that the pressure should be equal on both sides of your container, no matter what its shape is. Wow! Ludwig Boltzmann was a big proponent of the idea of atoms, and in the late 1800s, even though chemistry was well developed and physics was well developed, there were still big debates about whether atoms were real. Yes, it's a lovely question. What does it mean to argue whether atoms are real or not? Maybe they are just a friction. Maybe they are just a fiction. Maybe it's just kind of a mathematical tool to help us to order and understand the world. But it's possible that it doesn't really make sense to talk about the little microscopic things that are so small you can't even see them, right? Nobody has ever seen an atom, even today. I can show you the pictures, electron tunneling microscope pictures, but it's really a computer rendition of the scientific instruments of mass measurements. You can't see an atom with your eyes, and you never will, because they are too small. They are actually smaller than the wavelengths of the visible light, and you can't see something that's smaller than the wavelengths of the light you use to look at it. So, this was a big debate in the late 1800s. Are atoms real, or are they some kind of mathematical fiction, which is just being used to order and explain all of this data, like mathematics does? Right? Ludwig Boltzmann was really trying to make convincing mathematical arguments. But he didn't convince everybody, and he was quite a tragic figure. Ludwig Boltzmann ended up committing suicide in 1905. The reasons are a little bit mysterious, but some people think it was because he was so frustrated with the antagonism and argument that he was getting in scientific conferences and with meetings. Because there was a bunch of big powerful physicists, influential physicists who just didn't believe that it made sense to talk about an object that was so small you could never directly see it. Haha. It's ironic that Ludwig Boltzmann died in 1905, because that was the year that Albert Einstein published a paper on something called Brownian motion. Brownian motion is the following phenomenon. Take a little tiny object, but one that you can still just barely see, like a little dust grain or little piece of the pollen, and put it in a fluid and watch carefully. Mr. Brown did this experiment in the early 1800s, and what he saw was that the little grain would jiggle around kind of like a drunken sailor. Just this way and that way, kind of that, like the way I lecture to you. Jittering around the lecture hall. So, random motion, right? This motion, at first, Mr. Brownian said, maybe it's because that little pollen grain is alive. Maybe it's got some little flagella and it's moving around. It was a nice idea. Then he tried it with the dust and dirt, and no matter what he put in there, they all behaved the same way. So his idea was, well, he didn't know. Mr. Brown just thought it was a mystery, a random motion of particles. But Mr. Einstein in 1905 came up with a real quantitative explanation. He said, look, if you have a little, teeny object, it's just barely visible and it's surrounded by atoms, and they are real. They are working into it from all sides. Although it's random, on average, there is going to be equal number of bumps on the right and equal number of bumps on the left. From time to time, there might be, a few more bumps on the right side, just briefly, and so the thing will jitter to the left. Then, maybe later, there would be a few more bumps on the top and it will jitter down. So, that's why objects do a random work. It's because they are so small that it begins to become noticeable that atoms are around it. And they are smaller than it, but not infinitely smaller than that. Smaller than it. So now this is direct evidence of the physical existence of these little teeny balls. Whatever they are, these little atoms working into objects. There was a further evidence and understanding of the physical reality of the atom around this period of time, the late 1800s, and this other evidence came from the chemist in Russia by the name of Dmitry Mendeleev. Mendeleev was a chemistry professor. He was trying to understand all different elements that people knew about. Hydrogen, lithium, sodium, and all of these different elements, the elements that we now see on what's known as the periodic table, the table that shows up in the corner of the lecture hall when you take a high school science class. It was Mr. Mendeleev who invented that table, of course. He had little cards, and on each card he would write down the name of the element, the known weight mass, or the relative weight, I should say, of that element, and certain chemical properties, how reactive it was. For example, he noticed that if you just laid the cards out in the increasing mass, and you've got, 60 or 70 cards, these are all fundamental atoms that people know about in the late 1800s. Instead of just laying them out in a horizontal row, he started organizing them in a table, starting from the lightest, working his way up, heavier and heavier. In the columns, he would make sure the element going down a column would have the same chemical properties. Wow! So hydrogen is on the first row, and then he didn't know about helium yet. The next element was lithium, which weighed about 7 times as much as hydrogen, and it's very chemically similar. Wow! It's highly reactive. It's metallic, and hydrogen is gaseous, but the chemical reactive properties are about the same. Whoa! So in this way he formed a table. So cool, so savvy. And this table organized the atoms in a very beautiful way. In fact, it was stunning that you could do this. Some people were arguing about whether it was just an accident. In particular, there were certain places on that periodic table where there was a hole. It just didn't make sense to put an element there, so you just had to leave a gap and start continuing the elements further along in the table. Wow. Mendeleev saw that this table was significant. He didn't think it was an accident or numerology. He thought that it was telling us something about the nature of atoms. And indeed it was. So, for example, for one of those gaps, he could say, "Look, we haven't found any material, but if my table is correct, I predict the existence of the new material, a new fundamental material which is invisible by any chemical means, and it should have the following mass and the following chemical properties." He could really tell you what to look for. Whoa! So cool, so savvy, huh? So people went out to look for these things, and within the decade, gallium was discovered in the late 1800s, 1875. And germanium was discovered in 1896. There were the gaps in his table. So the discovery of these new elements predicted by chemists was really radical and profound proof, evidence that this idea that there were fundamental atoms and that they are ordinary and there is some sense to organization, it was all beginning to come together. Now, today, we still don't have direct visual evidence of the existence of the atoms, but we have incredibly powerful circumstantial evidence. Brownian motion, I think was the one that convinced the world. Albert Einstein's paper quantitatively predicted how these objects should move if atoms were real. This is a game you play in science. It is a what if. If I believe in the existence of an atom, then I conclude that a pollen grain will jiggle in the following ways, with the following frequency and so on.